You know what you're listening to? You're listening to the Deen Team, bringing the light of Islam right into your hearts.
Follow us on Facebook at the Deen Team Sydney radio program and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Deen Team Sydney.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Welcome our listeners to another episode on the Deen Team. With you today, your brother in Islam, Elaz Majani. And I have a very special guest with me. Dr. Zakaria Matthews is with us in the studio today. And Dr. Zakaria is, needs no introductions. He's very active within the Muslim community. And we want to get some health advice from him today on Ramadan. Dr. Zakaria, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam. How's your Ramadan so far?
Alhamdulillah, not too bad.
Alhamdulillah, subhanAllah. The first couple of days are always a bit tough on the body if you're not used to the fasting. But this month has so much bounties from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are in the days of mercy, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows mercy and makes things easy for us.
Alhamdulillah, Ramadan is a blessed month that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gifts His servants. And so really, especially at the beginning of Ramadan, it's important for us to review what are the health effects of fasting and what precautions we need to take, and how also to benefit from fasting in Ramadan, this blessed month.
SubhanAllah, we hear a lot from the mashayikh and the ulama about how we can sort of get spiritual gain from the month of Ramadan. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us a very famous hadith. He said, "Sumu tasihu," fast and you shall be healthy. How is it that a Muslim living in the West, living in Australia, can sort of benefit from the month of Ramadan health-wise?
Alhamdulillah, yeah. Definitely, one of the primary objectives of fasting in Ramadan is the spiritual dimension of gaining taqwa, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran. So that should be the primary focus. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't restrict it to that. There are many other benefits that we can get out of the month of Ramadan in terms of body, mind, and soul. So if we look at the soul, then it's the spiritual dimension of gaining taqwa. If we look at the mind, it's reconnecting with the Quran and connecting with the divine speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we look at the body, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us fasting specifically to discipline one important organ in the body, and that's the stomach.
SubhanAllah. I mean, that's one of the most difficult sunan of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to follow, to hold the desires of eating and really restraining yourself and constricting yourself so that you can, you know, eat little. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advises us to, you know, have a few morsels to keep the back straight. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, find today that, I'm not sure if it's a cultural thing, but people tend to do what they call, what the ulama call in Arabic, jama' ta'khir of the food. They join the breakfast, the lunch, and the brunch, and the dinner all into the futur meal. So is there something that the Muslim can do to sort of, is there a plan that the Muslim should do throughout the month of Ramadan?
Yeah, I think the starting point is a lack of correct understanding of Ramadan. So there's a misunderstanding about the importance of food, the importance of disciplining the stomach in Ramadan. And why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically choose fasting as a means to discipline us, and as a means, in fact, to gain that spirituality? And I think that's the disconnection that many people, unfortunately, don't realize, that the key to gaining increased spirituality, gaining that goal of taqwa at the end of the month of Ramadan or during the month of Ramadan, is through that pathway of fasting and disciplining the stomach. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting to us that discipline of this particular organ in terms of what is halal and permitted to us, Allah is saying you need to discipline that so that everything else of yours can be disciplined. So it's not only disciplining the stomach, it's disciplining the tongue. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever doesn't avoid false speech or foul speech in the month of Ramadan, then his fasting or her fasting hasn't really been of benefit in terms of that discipline dimension. So fasting and disciplining the stomach, I think, is key to a lot of these things. So what we need to do is correct people's misunderstanding about that and get people to realize that really that was key. And then we turn back to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in relation to food. Firstly, let's look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about food. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we need to eat halalan tayyiba.
Yes.
Eat what is halal, permitted to you, but also tayyib. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala combines the two, and we forget about the tayyib.
SubhanAllah.
We forget about what is wholesome and beneficial to us. And if we look, and so we need to obviously then look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to get to full understanding of what was tayyib. the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as you mentioned, recommended eating just enough to give you enough energy to do what you needed to do.
Subhanallah.
So it's fine. It's a really fine balance of knowing what is enough to eat, to consume in terms of energy for what we need to do, because anything in excess of that is going to be harmful to us. Meaning that we are consuming excess energy, and that's going to be either in what happens is most of the time it ends up in obesity. And what that's one of the things I wanted to highlight today was the problem of obesity. And one of the main factors and causes of obesity is overeating.
Subhanallah.
That people just eat way more than what they actually need in their daily activities.
Is this something that's a habit that people get used to eating so much so the stomach sort of gets used to eating certain amounts, or is this something that that is genetic? I mean, how does obesity come about?
It is mostly a habit. It's mostly a habit, and it relates to a weakness in being able to discipline our appetites, and especially the taste buds, and being satisfied, satiated with food. So that's the desire, the shahwat.
Subhanallah.
It's one of the main desires that people have. Some people have a lot of difficulty controlling and disciplining.
Subhanallah.
So that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us in Ramadan.
I guess this is the month of change. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala facilitates the perfect environment for us to change these bad habits. And I mean, He's given us a beautiful training course for us to discipline that nafs and discipline these shahawat, as you mentioned. So if the Muslim is fasting and he's eating sort of, you know, moderate amounts of food for futur and suhoor, should he expect that he should lose weight over the course of the month?
That's exactly correct. Because what in effect we should be doing, so you mentioned having a plan in the month of Ramadan. The plan should be to cut out that third middle meal, the meal in the middle of the day. So if you have, say we work on a three main meals a day, which is not ideal anyway, but if we work on the average, what is customary today, the three main meals of the day, breakfast, lunch and dinner. So if we cut out lunch, then that means we should be consuming a third less food every day in the month of Ramadan.
Subhanallah, I think we do the complete opposite of that, and we sort of consume extras, and you find that special foods come out in the month of Ramadan, and people increase in varieties in the month of Ramadan. And I'm not sure if this is a cultural thing, but I've seen it within my family where, I mean, my mother likes to cook different varieties, and she spends, exuberant amount of time in the kitchen trying to prepare so much food, and I mean, you can only eat so much.
I don't think it's a cultural thing. If we have a look at some of these statistics, for example, there's an Australian study looking at obesity levels, and it's a major problem in the Western societies. And the main cause, as I mentioned before, is overeating. So this Australian study found that there was an obesity problem, and obesity is defined as body weight greater than 20% of your ideal weight. So your actual weight is 20%. More than your ideal body weight. That level of obesity was only 4% in 1901. It increased to 30% in 2003, and then increased to 60% in 2007. So you can see we have an obesity epidemic almost, and related to that is another problem of diabetes, where there are increased rates of people developing diabetes related to obesity.
Subhanallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I mean, has given us an opportunity to defeat this this epidemic, as you call it, and this problem that's widespread in the community, especially within the Muslim community. What's your advice, for the Muslims out there that are fasting during the month of Ramadan, during this beautiful month, so that they can sort of control their food and their eating and sort of become healthier, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised?
I think it's to have the correct mindset entering into Ramadan, knowing that, okay, this is one thing that you're going to put on your plan. You're going to resist the temptation to overeat in the month. And as you mentioned before, that's what some people do, is they transfer lunch to dinner, so they have dinner plus lunch. But then there's also the extra extravagance with that meal at the
sweets, spa. The sweets.
There's a lot of sweets being consumed in the month of Ramadan. And that's also, excess sugar is not healthy. Eating too much fatty, a lot of fatty food, a lot of sugar, a lot of salt, is also not beneficial to their health. So I think the mindset entering Ramadan should be careful of that. Really be disciplined about what we're going to eat and how much of it we should be eating. And as you mentioned, the key indicator of whether you are sticking to that plan is whether you can actually lose weight during the month of Ramadan.
until when, at the eight time.
At the end of Ramadan, we should have lost weight because we should be consuming less. Because what happens to the stomach during the daylight hours while we're fasting from dawn to sunset, the stomach actually shrinks during the daylight hours.
SubhanAllah.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the stomach that opportunity while we're fasting, because we're not putting anything into it, it shrinks. So what we should avoid doing at iftar is we expanding it to its size it was at suhoor.
Yes.
But what happens with some people, unfortunately, they expand it to such an extent that they actually expand it way more than what it was at the time of suhoor. And that's why some people actually gain weight in Ramadan. And I use that as an indicator. I say, really, people should not be gaining weight in Ramadan. We should be losing weight or maintaining our weight. And if those people unfortunately gain weight, then they need to check how they're fasting. And this is my main concern, that we have turned Ramadan, which should be a month of fasting, into a month of feasting. So we're really losing the focus of the purpose. Food becomes so important. And I think what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing to us, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned this, that the shayateen are chained during the month of Ramadan. So yes. there's no waswas, there's no whispering from them. So it's really our own deficiencies. It's our own shahawat, our own desires that are being exposed in the month. So we have an opportunity to really look ourselves in the mirror and say, okay, this is who I really am. Now I can't blame temptation. Temptation has been taken away. It's just me. So I need to be able to do something about this. And that should be the challenge for us in Ramadan, inshallah.
So other than the mindset and, you know, planning ahead, I mean, is there recommended quantities of food that people should eat at
certain time? You mentioned the one hadith related to that hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us the bare minimum, which was eat just a few morsels, meaning each just such a quantity, small quantity, enough to give you the energy that you need for the day. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued the hadith and he said, if you're going to eat more, meaning he gave us the minimum. Then worst case scenario, he said, is the 3/3.
SubhanAllah.
Fill your stomach with a third of food, a third of liquid, and a third for air. That's the maximum. We misunderstand that hadith and we think, okay, that's the happy middle.
SubhanAllah.
That's the maximum. That's the maximum. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you're going to eat more, then let that be the end point for you. So we need to look at the quantity of food that we're consuming in Ramadan.
SubhanAllah. Well, what about fluids? I mean, we go throughout the day, and this is one of the things that I see non-Muslims, I mean, find this very surprising. All day, no water, so they find this very surprising. I mean, does the body really suffer from dehydration during daylight hours?
There is some dehydration, but the body has an amazing ability to adapt to that.
SubhanAllah.
So in the first few days, yes, we might suffer some dehydration during the first few days because the body is still getting used to the change.
Yes.
But once it gets used to the change, it will self-regulate in terms of how much fluid we lose through perspiration or through going to the bathroom. So the body will know, okay, it needs to conserve that liquid. But what we can do is we can assist that by making sure that at suhoor we drink some fluids during suhoor. And also the second thing, so drink enough fluids at suhoor as well as drink enough fluids during the nighttime. But then also stay away from things that are diuretics, that are going to make us lose fluids, like
such
caffeine.
As? Caffeine.
Caffeine. Wow. Caffeine in tea and coffee. So definitely don't have tea and coffee at suhoor.
SubhanAllah.
Don't have it then, because it's going to dehydrate you. Because it's got the caffeine in it. And caffeine is a diuretic, and it's going to make you lose fluid during the day while you're fasting.
Sure.
So if you're going to have a cup of tea, if you're going to have your green tea, for example, mm-hmm. which are the good teas, so if you're going to have the good herbal teas, then have that at night after your iftar.
SubhanAllah. Some of the Muslims in our community, I guess, they eat so much during futur time that they struggle to pray the Taraweeh prayer. I mean, this is a very, very common problem that you see. People they say, and they use the word, I can't breathe anymore, I can't breathe. They eat so much to the point where they say, I can't breathe anymore, there's no way I'm going to be able to stand for 8 rakat or 20 rakat or any tahajjud or any night prayer. I mean, this is something very important during the month of Ramadan.
This is the key. And this should actually make people realize how dangerous overeating is.
SubhanAllah.
Because overeating makes us tired, makes us sleepy, and less productive. So what we want to be is very productive in Ramadan, especially with the Taraweeh. because the tarawih is reconnecting with the kalamullah, with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to be in a state of mind where we are standing behind the imam, listening to the tilawah of the Quran, appreciating it, understanding it, fully connecting with it. But what happens is, if we overeat at iftar, we can't do that. It's actually a big struggle for us. So we come to Isha, Salat al-Isha, we come to Salah already tired, we're struggling there, we're falling asleep. So we lose all that benefit. And then whose fault was it? It was our fault.
Our fault, absolutely.
It was our fault. So what we need to do, and just quickly on that issue of eating and breaking the fast for Maghrib Salah, what we should do is try not to have your full meal before the Maghrib Salah also, because the same effect is going to happen there. So break your fast, have a few dates, drink some liquid, some water, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam recommended. Then pray your Maghrib, because what you need to do is just have that energy and enjoy your Maghrib Salah, and then come back for your main meal. But don't overeat during that main meal.
Absolutely.
Don't overeat, because it's going to have a negative impact on the ability to perform in the Taraweeh.
I mean, this is the month for Taraweeh. Yeah. This is for the month for Qiyam, and to, you know, stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and really try and understand the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as you mentioned, if you're feeling tired, feeling exhausted, and your body's struggling to digest all that food and process that food, then you're not going to have much connection with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
In fact, what I would recommend, and this is closer to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is rather than having three big meals a day, is having fewer smaller meals, more smaller meals. So have a small meal at suhoor, have a small meal at iftar, and when you come back from taraweeh, just have a light snack before you're getting ready to go to bed. Ideally, we shouldn't be eating 1 hour before we sleep. You should try to stop eating 1 hour before you go to bed, because if you do eat closer to your sleeping time, it affects your sleep as well. And sometimes we wonder why we're not having good quality sleep. It's because the body's confused. You're telling the body you're giving the body two mixed messages.
Yes.
If you just had, especially people who have a big meal and then go and sleep.
Subhanallah.
It affects their sleep. They don't have proper quality sleep. Because the body is thinking, should I digest this food or should I sleep? Because when you sleep, everything shuts down.
Yes.
But now the body is trying to sleep, but it's also trying to digest the food. So the recommendation there is at least 1 hour before you go to bed, try not to have anything to eat.
I mean, I guess this is really much needed advice for the Muslim community out there listening to us on the radio today. And I mean, what other advice do you have for the Muslims that are fasting during the month from a health perspective?
Yeah, so now the important thing is the type of foods that we eat. The first thing is also following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to have the suhoor. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in several hadith that there is barakah in the suhoor. Barakah means blessings. And what that blessing is, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But we can only estimate that. What that blessing could be is that it helps you with your fast. So you're actually productive during your day, and your fasting doesn't affect your ability to do your work. And this is another misunderstanding that people do, is they change their days into nights and the nights into days.
Subhanallah. Miss the objective, they completely miss the objective.
Completely miss the objective of Ramadan. Ramadan is not a time to be lazy, to be unproductive, to take time off. In fact, if we have a look at the major events that happened in the history of Islam, they happened during the month of Ramadan.
Like the Battle of Badr, for example.
Major events. World-changing events happened during the month of Ramadan. And this is a key from Allah. This is a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we need to be productive. And in fact, if we follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we can be more productive in Ramadan. And this will really shock non-Muslims. This will amaze them. Because their perception will be, okay, you're a worker, you're coming into work, your boss finds out you're fasting, he thinks, okay, this guy's going to be
tired, exhausted,
he's going to be slow, he's not going to be as productive, I can't expect much out of this employee. But if you follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you can actually show him that you're more productive during Ramadan. Yes, towards the afternoon, late afternoon, between now in winter, between Asr and Maghrib, yes, the body naturally will slow down. But your productive time, and this is another recommendation I make, is try not to go to sleep after Fajr. Try not to go to sleep after Fajr.
So stay awake after Fajr.
Stay awake after Fajr. Read your Quran. Do whatever you need to do. If you can go to work early, start your work hour early. Start your work day earlier and finish early in the afternoon, so that you can come back and rest a little bit before iftar. Also the issue of sleep. So sorry, just going back to the issue of suhoor. So suhoor is really important. And the Prophet ﷺ didn't say we need to have a big breakfast. Mm-hmm. just keep it simple.
Yes.
And what you can do is eat natural foods, eat slow digesting foods, so food that will last you longer.
What are like some examples of these?
Wholemeal, grains, legumes, pasta. They take a longer time to break down, so they produce energy for much longer. Whereas at iftar, we need to eat quick burning foods like dates. Because they release sugar very, very quickly. So don't have your dates at suhoor, have your dates at iftar
time.
Because that's when you need the energy. So you need fast digesting food to give you back that energy that you lost during the day of fasting. Another recommendation is some people miss the opportunity of praying qiyamul layl or tahajjud before suhoor.
Because they're busy eating?
We're already getting up. We're already getting up for suhoor. So what you should do, in fact, then, is just pray two raka'ah before you have your breakfast. Then you've gained the tahajjud. And you can gain that tahajjud the whole month of Ramadan.
Subhanallah. As if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us an opportunity to practice this beautiful sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
And all it takes is two raka'ah. It's going to take you less than 5 minutes to pray those two raka'ah. And then you'll also be following in another sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said in the hadith, In the month of Ramadan, some of the scholars say this may apply, some say it doesn't apply. Where the shaitan, while we're sleeping, ties three knots.
Yes.
And you untie these three knots by doing three things, right?
SubhanAllah.
The first thing you do is you say the dua when you wake up. That you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving your life back after you were sleeping.
Taken away.
And then you're going to make wudu, unties the second knot. And then you pray salah, and it unties the third knot. And the outcome of that hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in that hadith, when you do those three things, and you lessen the effect of shaitan, It is in terms of productivity. You will have a very productive day if you do that.
And I'm sure a lot of our listeners can relate to this. I mean, the day that you wake up, go to the mosque and pray Fajr, you have a much more productive day than a day that where you're missing Salah in the Masjid, or for example missing Fajr altogether. Yeah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so merciful that He gives us an opportunity to reconnect with Him. And Ramadan, the beautiful month of Ramadan, is the month of mercy, the month where we reconnect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and where we try and seek His pleasure as much as we can. And it's really about the month of changing habits. So, I mean, I'm really interested in this health, this health topic, because it's very relevant to a lot of Muslims, a lot of our listeners out there. What about for females, really? Is there something specific to females that we can speak about?
No, it applies across the board for men and women. The only issue that might impact some of our sisters who are pregnant or breastfeeding during the month of Ramadan, they need to seek advice from their physicians, from their medical practitioners, as to whether it is safe for them to fast while they are pregnant or while they are breastfeeding. And really, it's a decision that each mother needs to take in consultation with medical advice. They have done some studies on the effect of Ramadan fasting on birth weight, a pregnant woman during Ramadan, and they found that it had a marginal effect on birth weight, but not detrimental. So people can fast while they're pregnant if it is safe for them to do so. The same thing with breastfeeding, they can do the same thing. The other issue of diabetes, patients with diabetes, again, they need to consult with their medical practitioners to see how severe their diabetes is, whether they can fast or not. There are some, if it's, for example, if it's a mild case of diabetes, the doctor can say, okay, you can fast, but then adjust their medication in a way that it can be safe for them to fast.
So it's really like a case-by-case scenario. Yep. A rule of thumb that fits everyone. Each person needs to seek consultation with a physician.
Yeah. And that's the beauty of Islam.
SubhanAllah.
The beauty of Islam is that the guidelines are there, the regulations are there, but then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a concession for each individual person and their circumstance, what situation they face.
SubhanAllah. Look, Dr. Zakaria, I remember when when I was a bit younger and I used to go to the gym, and they used to say it's not only about the food intake that you've got to control, it's also about the physical exercise what you exert in terms of exercise. What kind of exercise can people do in Ramadan to stay fit and try and reduce their weight as well?
The people who have a regular exercise routine should try to continue that during the Ramadan. Obviously, they need to balance their time commitments, and they may have to cut their time in half, the time that they were spending exercising, because they may want to allocate greater time to their ibadah. So that's going to be a balancing act for some people to do. But I recommend that people not stop their training routines. The only recommendation that the only thing that they need to have a look at what type of training they're doing. So if people do a lot of cardio training, then that's going to impact on their fluid intake, and it might cause them to be dehydrated more often. They may want to transfer that cardio training to nighttime rather than during the daytime if they were doing that. If they were doing weight training and non-cardio type training, they can probably still do that in the morning and during the day.
And fast for the rest of the day.
Yeah. But I would advise against doing full cardio training in the morning because it's really going to dehydrate them and they won't have any ability to replace the fluids that they lose, because when you're doing cardio training, you lose a lot of liquid, a lot of fluid.
SubhanAllah.
And you need to replace that. So the better time to do that would be at night.
And of course, if anyone lives close to the mosque and they're in walking distance, a great time, opportunity is to walk to the mosque and get the physical activity happening on the way to the mosque, on the way back from the mosque.
Exactly. And the Taraweeh itself is physical training.
SubhanAllah.
The Taraweeh itself, because we are doing so many more raka'ah in Ramadan, that itself becomes physical training.
So it's not only physical, it's also spiritual training as well.
Yeah.
What a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. SubhanAllah. Brother, Dr. Zakari Matthews, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us a lot of advice. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is our role model, our teacher, and he explained to us how to fast in the month of Ramadan. He explained to us how to stay healthy. He is the ultimate role model for us as Muslims. What prophetic tradition is there from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that teaches us how to go on about our day to day in Ramadan?
Okay, the three advices that I generally have for putting together a plan for Ramadan, and I call this the Ramadan self-reform plan. There are three aspects to it. It's the body, mind, and soul, and looking after all three of those aspects of the individual in terms of self-reform. So in terms of our body, we spoke a lot about this today, the physical discipline, and that's really key, physical discipline. So controlling our desires, our appetites, and letting our stomachs not control us, we control it.
SubhanAllah, master and slave.
Yeah, so the stomach is a slave to me, I'm not a slave to my stomach.
SubhanAllah.
So that's what we need to achieve at the end of Ramadan. And a key performance indicator we can use for that is weight loss. The other thing with that is also better health. So use Ramadan as a time to get rid of all those bad habits, bad eating habits. Sometimes we pick up really bad eating habits. We eat a lot of junk food. We eat a lot of sugar sweets, a lot of salty food, a lot of fatty food. Look at what we're eating. Change that and replace it with foods that are a lot healthier. For example, white rice to brown rice. White sugar to brown natural sugar. Cutting the intake of salt and sugar. Having your tea without sugar. Just getting rid of sugar completely. Maybe replacing sugar with honey if you want to have something sweet. So that's an opportunity we can do that. But then also, you were going to say?
I was just going to say sometimes when non-Muslims ask me about fasting and they're quite... they don't know much about Islam. I tell them it's like a detox. So does fasting have a detox effect on the body?
Yeah, it does. It does.
SubhanAllah.
It does. It gives you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us 1 month because it helps in terms of physically also to cleanse the body, that 1 month process. But also there's the dimension of replacing bad habits. It generally takes about 30 days to get rid of a bad habit.
SubhanAllah.
So that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the month of Ramadan for. But then also the physical discipline is the tongue, controlling our tongues, controlling our eyes, controlling our ears, what we're talking about. So fast not only the stomach, but fast everything else.
Of course.
And my recommendation during the month of Ramadan is get rid of the TV. Or don't watch TV during the month of Ramadan. Rather connect with the Quran. Use the Quran as the most important thing.
Very good.
And that will help us with our behavior reform. The second is the mind, and that's intellectual discipline. So connecting with Allah through the Quran, spending a lot of time with the Quran, and maximizing our time and how we use it. So we need to spend quality time with the Quran, better understanding of the Quran. So I also recommend, for example, yes, read the Quran, but it's more important to understand what we're reading.
Absolutely.
I know there is a lot of advantage in reading the Quran, but for a lot of us who don't fully appreciate the Arabic language, what would be better? Now, in terms of fiqh al-awliyat, the fiqh of priorities, we should try to do both. So read the Quran, improve our reading of the Quran, but also gain access to the meaning, even if it is through translated understanding of the Quran, because that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this book of guidance. But then more important to that is once we connect with the Quran, we understand the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how are we going to practically implement that in our lives?
Practice.
How are we going to, what are we going to, because it's a book of guidance, so we need to use the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the third one is the soul, the spiritual discipline, and that's taqwa. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran that we need to gain taqwa out of Ramadan, which is piety. It is a safeguard from committing sin. And the key factor, outcome measure for that is an improved ability to resist sin, to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that's what taqwa should do. As our taqwa increases, our ability to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should decrease.
Yes.
The second is the Qiyamul Layl. So we have the Taraweeh, which is our pre-sleep night prayer. But then there's also the pre-breakfast, as I recommended, just making those two raka'ah. So we'll almost be in a state of perpetual tahajjud if we did that. So we did tahajjud before we go to sleep, which is the Taraweeh. We go to bed, we wake up, we pray another two raka'ah tahajjud. It's almost so connected.
SubhanAllah.
So that will increase our consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it will also result in a moral reform. So our ability to be obedient slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will improve during this month.
Subhanahu wa ta'ala.
We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us with that, inshallah.
Alhamdulillah. It seems subhanAllah, that you've got everything from a holistic point of view, that there's a mind component, a body component, a soul component. And the Muslim that's fasting in the month of Ramadan needs to work on every single one of these components so that they can get the benefit out of the month of Ramadan. Yeah.
And that's the challenge. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how many more Ramadans we're going to have left.
SubhanAllah.
So we may as well make the most of this one that we have right now.
Of course.
And we'll ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with more. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to make the most use of it right now.
MashaAllah. Alhamdulillah. This is very, very good advice, brother Dr. Zakaria Mathew. Jazakallah khair. It's been a very beneficial segment, I would say, in terms of how to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the month of Ramadan and also become healthier. So we can apply the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he says, "Sumu tasihu." And the advice of Dr. Zakaria in terms of, what about medication? This is another important thing that a lot of people will be asking questions about. How does it work for certain medications during the month of Ramadan?
Okay, so people need to consult with their doctors about what is safe to take while they're fasting. And some medications, for example, some people might be taking medications 3 times a day. They can actually switch it to longer acting medication, if that's possible for them, where they can take it at suhoor and take it at iftar. So there are some options that doctors can manage with that. But then there's some routes of administration that sometimes confuse people as to whether it actually breaks their fast. For example, routes of administration which do not break the fast include eye and ear drops. Don't break the fast.
This is with all madhahib?
Yeah. This is the general consensus. This was a fiqh medical seminar that was held in Morocco in 1997, where they got a lot of the ulama, the fuqaha, and medical physicians, doctors, to come together and decide on these issues. There are going to be some differences with some of the madhahib on this issue. With the eye and ear drops, you might taste some of it in your taste, but as long as you don't swallow that, then it shouldn't break your fast.
Yes.
And the other thing is that eye and ear drops don't classify as food. So it would be like getting some dust in your mouth and you accidentally swallow that or unintentionally swallow it. It doesn't break your fast. So the same concept with eye and ear drops. Skin ointments and creams also don't break your fast. Injections don't break your fast. So taking vaccinations during the month of Ramadan is permissible, as long as these injections are not classified as IV nutrition. So if somebody's going to dehydrate it and they need to put the person on a drip and they're going to give them dextrose,
that would break
or
their fast.
Salt water, then that's going to break their fast, definitely. Mm-hmm. But if it's just a normal injection, whether it's under the skin, into the muscle or into the vein, it's not classified as food.
What about insulin, for example?
The same thing with insulin.
Same thing.
The same thing with insulin. So diabetics, again, with diabetics, I would be cautious with that, because especially if they're taking insulin, then it could be that the diabetes is at a state where they cannot fast.
SubhanAllah.
Because a lot of the insulin, people who are on insulin need to have a meal after they've taken their injections.
Sure, sure.
So yeah, that's something that they will need to discuss with their doctors. Also some routes of administration that don't break the fast, oxygen, anesthetic gases, but going under anesthesia anyway, is something that the person needs to consult with their doctor, whether that's going to be possible for them to fast or not. Mouthwashes and gargles also, generally, if they are not swallowed. So again, if they are not swallowed. The majority of the scholars, there was a minority that did not agree with this. Majority added intranasal sprays, so intranasal sprays and drops.
So like Nasonex or something like that?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And also the inhalers. For asthma. So people who are asthmatic, if they take their inhalers, it won't break their fast. Even though they might get a bit of the taste in their mouth, but again, it's an aerosol. It's not in a liquid food form,
yes.
So it doesn't classify as food, and it doesn't go through the normal passage of the esophagus into the stomach. There might be some particles going in there, but they will say that that is insignificant.
Subhanallah. Dr. Zakaria Matthews, Jazakallah khair. This has been a very, very informative session and episode for our listeners out there. And alhamdulillah rabbil alamin, we should all put the intention that by the end of the month of Ramadan, we want to reduce weight. We want to try and not make this Ramadan a spiritual, uplifting event. We also want to make it an event where we become healthier. And as you mentioned earlier on, I mean, the healthier you are, the less food intake you take, the more productive you will be. And this is really the idea in the month of Ramadan, that we become more productive, we become better people, we get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's really about change. I mean, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us perfect conditions for change. I mean, sometimes you find that there's some life coaches that tell you change your life in 30 days or lose weight in 30 days. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling you, get better habits, become a better Muslim, get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, become a healthier person within these 30 days of Ramadan. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those that act upon what they what they hear. And Jazakallah khair, Dr. Zakaria Matthews, for joining us on the Deen team. Thank you, listeners, for tuning in. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. Until next time, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Follow us on Facebook at the Deen Team Sydney Radio Program and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Deen Team Sydney.